Good morning and welcome to the sixth meeting of the Economy, Jobs and Fair Work Committee. First of all, we have a decision on taking items 4 and 6 on the agenda in private. Is the committee agreed to take those items in private?
Yes.
And second, item 2 on the agenda is a decision by the committee to consider the draft report on the draft climate change plan in private at future meetings, and also consideration of an EU research paper and approach paper on its data inquiry. And the decision is whether those can be taken in private. Are we agreed that they should be taken
Yes.
in private? Thank you. We have today three witnesses in this session, and I'd welcome them to the committee. First of all, Rod Ashley, who's Chief Executive of Airdrie Savings Bank. Second, Wendy Dunsmore, who's Regional Officer of Unite the Union. And third, Professor Charles Munn. So may I welcome all three of you to the committee this morning. And you're here, as you will know, to discuss the decision of Airdrie Savings Bank to close. May I first of all invite members of the committee to state any interest they may have in the matter of the Airdrie Savings Bank. John Mason.
Yes, well, I would declare that I bank with the Airdrie Savings Bank and virtually all my money is with them.
Thank you. The matter will proceed by committee members putting questions to the witnesses, and if you wish to come in on any question, then please simply indicate by raising your hand. No need to work the microphones, that's dealt with by the sound desk. So if committee members could keep questions succinct and witnesses perhaps also bear that in mind, and also the fact you don't have to answer every question. We'll start, first of all, I have a question for Rod Ashley, and that is about the background of the decision to close Airdrie Savings Bank. And really what I'm interested in is the procedure that was followed in coming to that decision, first of all. It's just that members of the public may not understand how it works, so it might be helpful to start off with some explanation of that.
Would you be familiar with the corporate structure of the bank?
Well, I'm happy for you to give a very quick summary of that.
So the bank is in fact a savings bank under the 1819 Act. It has trustees, so it's not a corporate structure as we would expect. In 21st century governance, it is a mutual. I would consider it part of the social enterprise sector, so it's not a normal corporate structure. Having said that, it operates with that kind of normal corporate governance structure in place, with a board, subcommittees, and other governance matters as required under the various acts and under the banking regulation that we have at the moment. So in terms of the background to the decision to close the bank, I think as a normal board, we are always looking strategically at what the options are in relation to our banking structure. We undertook a strategic review of the options for the bank, and that led us to the decision that the medium to long term position for the bank was sufficiently uncertain that in order to act in the best interests of the depositors, we would take the decision at this point in time in order to conduct an orderly wind down of the bank affairs in order that there might be a community benefit at the end of the wind down process.
And you say in the interest of the depositors, can you expand on that?
So under the 1819 Act, the obligation of the governance and of the trustees is to act in the best interests of the depositors. So therefore, you could have ended up in a situation where the bank may have continued making losses for a number of years to come, and there would come a point by which the control of any wind down would be taken out of the hands of the local community and out of the local trustees, and would be handled by the regulators at that point. And the bank did not wish that to happen. They wished to retain control of what was happening, of the destiny of the bank, and therefore the best interests of the depositors.
You say continue making losses. Was it the case that the bank was making losses at this stage?
Yes.
And the decision was taken by the Board of Trustees, is that correct?
That's correct.
And did the Board of Trustees have to run that decision by anyone? Are they accountable to anyone in particular?
So the Board of Trustees internally are not accountable to anyone, but a modern bank runs hand in hand with the regulators, and so both Prudential Regulation Authority and Financial Conduct Authority were aware of what the board decision was going to be and knew that that was going in that direction.
I don't know if Professor Munn, whether you have any comment on that at this stage?
Yeah, just one point, or 2 points really. One is to note that the trustees are not remunerated. I believe that's still the case. And they are volunteers. The second is that there has been, I should explain, I wrote the history of the Airdrie Savings Bank to celebrate its 175th anniversary 7 years ago. The bank has a long tradition, of course, as you know, but there's a long history too of dealing with regulators, and it's not always been a happy experience, largely because the Airdrie Savings Bank for the last 40 years or so has been unique. And so it's been quite awkward at times for regulators in London, whether it was the Bank of England or the Financial Services Authority, to understand what it was that they were dealing with. So the book tells a story. I'll not elaborate, but simply to say that there have been quite challenging times, as for example when regulators in London at one period asked the Airdrie Savings Bank for a full detailed statement on its international exposures. Well, apart from selling the occasional traveller's cheque, it didn't have any.
What is the full title of your book, for those who may be interested?
It's simply called Airdrie Savings Bank, A History, and is available from the bank. I think you've still got...
I can confirm we still have copies available.
thank you very much for that. No doubt we'll bring Wendy Dunsmore in on relevant questions as we come to issues that touch on your remit, but I'll pass now to Richard Leonard to ask some further questions.
Thanks very much indeed, Convener. I mean, Professor Munn alluded to the long view, and there are some people who would ask the question, why, if the bank can survive two world wars and the great crash of 1929, does it find itself at this point in its history facing closure?
Mm. Well, it's not always been an easy run. There's a notion around, I think, in the minds of some people I've spoken to about this, who think that running the Airdrie Savings Bank, especially after all the nice things that were said about it at the time of the crisis, that it's always been an easy ride. You know, it hasn't. You know, there have been many, many challenges for it. You know, in the 1970s, for example, there was almost the opposite challenge of the one that exists now, when inflation was very high and interest rates were high. Now we've got the exact opposite, and as I think it says in the book someplace, the margin between lending and borrowing rates is so narrow now that it's difficult, as Rod has said, for the bank to make enough of a surplus to pay its way.
Yeah, I mean, I understand that's one of the reasons that lies behind the era of low interest rates is not only penalising savers, it's presumably penalising the model of business that the Airdrie Savings Bank operates through. I mean, Mr. Ashley, could you explain a little bit more about what happens when Mr. Mason deposits his money in the bank? What do you do with it, and where does it go?
I can do. So the Airdrie Savings Bank is entirely retail deposit funded. That is, our customers raise all the deposits and the funds that we use. So the traditional model of a savings bank would be that they didn't lend any money to customers at all. And as, again, in fact, Charles will no doubt be able to correct me with the dates, but it was only around the mid-1980s that the bank started lending any money to any customers. And in fact, QC opinion had to be obtained before it was possible to ascertain whether that was possible. And by the time we came to when I joined the bank, which was in 2013, we were roughly in the position where, of the deposits we had, About a third of those were lent out to customers. Now, if you contrast that with many of the other high street banks, where that will be closer to 75 or 80% lent out, we had a third lent to other banks in the form of deposits with other banks. Traditionally and historically, those banks had acted in a fraternal nature towards Airdrie Savings Bank and perhaps had given us a slightly higher rate than might have been afforded elsewhere. That didn't happen anymore. And a third of the other deposits were invested in government bonds and gilts. So generally, low risk use of the funds in accordance with the bank practice. But principally since 2008, 2009, two of those thirds have been yielding very little, and the other third, the lending to the customers, has been under pressure from the low interest rate environment, the low inflationary position we've been in, and consequently, for a savings bank, it's very difficult to make any money at that return. Certainly, as Mr. Mason will concur, no doubt, very difficult to give any return to depositors whatsoever in that environment.
I mean, was there any consideration given, or is it possible within the terms that frame the operation of the bank, whether it's the 1819 Act or subsequent legislation, was there any reason why you couldn't look at investing Mr. Mason and other depositors' money elsewhere, almost like a pension fund might do? So instead of just simply putting it in the bank or another bank, could you have looked at other forms of investment vehicles in order to try to increase the yield?
The range of investments with which the bank is able to go, and certainly within its policies, is narrow. And obviously that also depends particularly on risk appetite in relation to that. And the bank has always, first and foremost, been a very prudent investment kind of vehicle. As I was saying at the beginning, the trustees, overarching duty of care is to act in the best interests of depositors. And so the kind of risk profile that we would be prepared to look at there would be low and in keeping with what you'd expect the organisation to be.
I think Gordon McMahon wanted to come in on a point there.
Well, it was just about the loss making. I was wanting to ask, is that purely due to the narrow margin that you're referring to, or has there been any additional cost placed on the bank since the crash of 2008?
So it's a combination of two factors. The bank, because of its operating model, has traditionally a very high cost to income ratio if compared to peers or other banks. So since the period since 2008, we've embarked on a number of cost-cutting measures and income-increasing measures, which the customers have worked with us on that to implement them. Some of them quite unpalatable to them, but they've been loyal to the customer base. So we've basically done both there. There is no question that there are additional costs since 2008 that have come along as banking throughout the world and throughout Europe is reformed. There's no question there's a bigger burden of regulatory compliance than there potentially was previously. And there's no real indication that is reaching a plateau. And it changes on a frequent basis as well. You may well, for example, if I give you a short example, the financial services compensation scheme limit changed to 75,000 18 months ago, and it's just changed back to 85,000, which it was prior to that. A factor completely out with our bank's control and actually out with the UK control is my understanding of that, but nevertheless quite an onerous project in both directions for a bank of our size to implement the change to notify customers of the decrease and then subsequently to put the position back to where it was.
Presumably in previous years you had built up a level of reserves so that if there was the odd year when you made a loss, you'd be able to make that up from your reserves. I mean, you know, how many years have you been running at a loss, and how much reserves did you have that would have compensated that for a few future years?
So the reserves of the bank, that's correct. The only way that the bank can build up reserves is, are through retained profits.
Yeah.
So over the years that the bank's been in existence, any profits over and above the deposits returned to customers have been invested in the retained reserves. And consequently, for exactly that reason, the board had built up a position of reserves, which they were subsequently using over the last number of years, as they felt that this was the way that they supported investment back into the community. They were utilising the reserves for that effect. But the reserves have been decreasing and were forecast to continue to decrease. And so, as I was mentioning earlier, they didn't want to get to a position where the capital requirements were not being met by them, because they would lose control at that point. So yes is the short answer to your question.
Now, I don't know if Professor Munn wanted to come in on any of these questions. I was then going to move to a question from Bill Bowman and then Julian Martin.
Just a small point, and that is that, following on from what Rod has just said, the other element of that is the need for future investment in the fabric and in the technology of the bank. And that too can only come from accumulated reserves. And if these are not actually accumulating, then it makes the prospect of keeping the bank up to date and its technology and its fabric increasingly difficult.
Right. Thank you. Bill Bowman.
Thank you to Mr. Ashley again. I think you said earlier that it was the trustees that took the decision to have the wind down. Is that correct?
Yes, I can clarify that a little bit if you'd like me to.
What I was going to ask was that to ask the background of the individuals who are trustees. Are they experienced in the financial sector, or did they take, or what external advice did they take on that decision?
Okay, let me clarify. So the trustees ultimately are the decision-taking body. Because of changes, again, to banking regulation and the fact that we're under an old act, the definition of the decision-making body within the bank is now that there's a board, and the board includes those individuals who are also covered by the senior manager's regime, which is from the FCA and the PRA. So sitting, if I describe them as board, in addition to the trustee members, are the chairman of the board, who's an independent non-executive, the CEO, myself, and the chief financial officer. The three of us would also be considered as part of the wider board and the decision-making process on that basis. We conducted quite an extensive strategic review, which covered a period over 12 months. We were supported at various phases within that, with views from outside consultancy agencies on what we were looking for before we arrived at the conclusion that we did.
May I ask what outside consultancy agencies you relied on?
We work quite closely with the big four accountancy firms. The audit firm for Deloitte, for example, for the bank, but we also have relationship with the other accountancy consultancies.
Did you take advice from banking experts of whatever sort, apart from these accountants that you refer to?
I think the answer to that is yes, because the bank is involved in various forum and groups through myself and other members where we took a judgment and discussion about a number of the kind of strategic options that we were looking at there. We've also discussed the position with Scottish Government, who have been cited on what we've been doing for the last couple of years, and we've been up having meetings here. So can I just jump back to Mr. Bowman's question, because I've just remembered that I didn't fully answer the second part of your question there, which was the skills and qualifications of the other board members. So on that, you have a number of bankers. So traditionally, you would have had the kind of local townspeople who would be the trustees, but increasingly now we have people with a banking background sitting on the board of trustees. So for example, I have a couple of lawyers, we have accountants there with background in banking knowledge, I have a chief risk officer as well. So there is quite a strong level of banking and financial services awareness now on the board and within the trustee group. Sorry, Chair.
Gillian Martin.
I just want to say I can't have been alone in feeling very disappointed when I heard the news that you were going to close, and I think a lot of people in Scotland who look to the Airdrie Savings Bank to be an alternative to mainstream banking would have shared my thoughts there. I want to pick up something that Professor Munn said about modernisation, and obviously that I want to know to what extent the inability to maybe to modernise to the extent of maybe internet banking, providing a more cashless service, whatever, had an impact on your decision, and what you did to maybe get assistance from agencies such as Scottish Enterprise, Scottish Government, your local authority to assist you in maybe modernising, and how that maybe just perhaps didn't come to fruition or did.
Yeah, so the traditional offering from the bank at the moment is and has been very branch-based. In around 2010, I think, they implemented an internet banking offering, developed that and added it on. This was particularly useful for the business banking customers who were looking for that. Obviously, since 2010, everything has moved on. The digital age has arrived with even more force, and our offering is behind that curve. And the investigation we've done into the sort of investment levels that would be required in order to move us forward with that, we're going to be out with the capabilities of the bank, given its retained reserves position and the investment that we would need to have on that kind of basis. In terms of the discussions that we've had, we are an account managed firm with Scottish Enterprise, who we worked closely with for a number of introductory contacts following our meetings up here at Holyrood. And one of the strategic areas that we looked in was diversification of product offering for the bank to try and spread the products that we had there. And Scottish Enterprise were able to offer us some support in that capacity through contribution towards specific project employment costs in order to get two specific projects we undertook with them underway.
And I know that people have turned to the Airdrie Savings Bank when they have lost faith in the commercial banking sector, for example, round about the crash, after the Scottish independence referendum. I know that you had a surge in people wanting to bank with you as well. Did you feel at the time when you had those people coming to you that you were limiting the amount of people could come to you because you were unable to modernise? Was that a factor? I mean, were you unable to grow, or did you not want to particularly grow?
I didn't get a sense that there was anyone who wanted to join us that was unable to join us. Mm-hmm. I think potentially there was a slight mismatch between perhaps expectation or thought that might exist in terms of banking services for some of the customers who were coming to us and what the actual reality of the situation was in terms of at the time we had eight branches decreased down to three. We didn't have mobile banking apps. Our current account service cost £5 a month, unlike a number of with other banks. But certainly, I think anyone who wanted to come and who spoke to me about coming to join us for the reasons they were was welcomed in and able to open accounts with us.
Okay, thank you.
Jackie Bailey.
I'm curious to know the extent of your contact with the Scottish Government. So, who did you meet? What was discussed? What was your ask of them?
Jackie, nice to see you again. I don't have my notes of the meeting with me, but essentially we were up. We met with Mr. Swinney. Well, that was within his brief. Our local MSP is Alec Neil, and now Richard is also one of our local MSPs. So we had two or three committee meetings around that where they were able to direct and push us in the direction of a number of contacts, which I then subsequently followed up on various meetings through Scottish Enterprise, with Scottish Investment Bank, Green Investment Bank, these kind of contacts that we were put in touch with to see if there was areas that we could, principally we were looking to see if there were other areas we could lend into in that regard.
And did that achieve any outcome?
I think I would say it was moderately successful. One of the challenges we certainly came up against was that in reality, for a lot of the SME lending, we're really very small, and our maximum lend was potentially smaller than a number of projects that we were looking at there. And it was also taking us into areas which were very interesting and important, but not areas that we had a particular skill set involved in. So we were looking at developing and who we might work with in that area. A particular area that we did launch the project was with social enterprises, and we established the relationship with SCRT, Scottish Community Reinvestment Trust, there again supported through Scottish Government to try and make Airdrie Savings Bank at least one of the main banks that would be thought of when the social enterprise was looking at banking facilities.
So how much did that result in terms of increased lending?
It did result in some increased lending, but as you know, the wheels turn slower in some ways in that kind of sector as everybody gets together and decides what's going to happen, and then there's a lot of projects that are thought of and potentially don't come to fruition. So we did quite a lot of work, and we were moving in that area, and we did some additional lending, but it wasn't going to be a kind of a bank-changing amount of lending that we were able to do.
Okay, that's helpful to know. Can I turn to staff and to Wendy, because I'm obviously keen to know, I think you have 70 members of staff and the PACE team have been in, but actually how easy is it going to be to relocate people with very particular skills, given that the banking sector overall appears to be contracting in terms of job numbers?
Personally, I think Airdrie Savings Bank staff are an absolute catch for every other bank. And the reason I'm saying that is Airdrie Savings Bank, I've worked in the finance sector area for a long time as a Unite officer, and Airdrie Savings Bank's commitment to training for their staff is exceptional compared to every other bank, and their proportion of people who've got banking degrees or their chartered accounts and all the rest of it is far, far higher than any other bank. So I think if I was TSB, Lloyds or anyone like that, I would be hanging about Airdrie Savings Bank to snap these people up, because their talent is incredible and they've got the banking qualifications that no other bank now even actually explore.
Okay. So how many people are you losing just now? Are you losing any just now?
To support what Wendy's saying, actually, I am seeing a handful of staff at the moment who have gone out and been successful in obtaining other jobs in the financial services area.
Yeah.
I think we've begun first consultation now, and we're just at that stage. The 28th of April is the key date for that, isn't it?
The bank is actually doing is a wind down, and it's properly structured, which is far better than the position we were in 2009 when everybody was just chased their tails trying to deal with 40,000 job losses because of mismanagement. And that's the shame of the big companies, the big banks, because Airdrie Savings Bank is becoming a bit of a victim to their own success, because they weren't touched in 2009. Mm-hmm. They never had the same impact as HBOS, Lloyds, Royal Bank or any of those individuals, and now they're having this impact with this talented workforce, and that's the tragedy of this, not just the last investment bank last trustee bank in the UK. It's the workforce are getting impacted because of that, and I have to say we're now going through a consultation process where there is going to be some staff that are going to be made redundant second quarter of this year, but we're doing that in a very organised way. And the one thing I would also say is Airdrie Savings Bank is properly committed to good industrial relations, insofar as if you look at what happened in the years from 2000 onwards, or even probably before that, other banks did away with paying staff for their skills. What they did is they paid staff for what they could sell and miss-sell. Airdrie Savings Bank never went down that road. They rewarded staff every year for the skills that they learned, not for what they've sold, and they never were targeted in sales. So they did the proper banking stuff from the 70s, 80s, where all the banks were really successful and steady. Airdrie Savings Bank never lost that ethos, and they are now a victim because of that, and yet the other banks are still able to you'll meet the customer's needs, whatever way you want to wrap that up, it's selling. And Airdrie Savings Bank's never forced themselves on that, and they don't have the products. So if you look at a Bank of Scotland account, if you go into the Bank of Scotland, they're not going to make any money in my deposits, but they're going to make money in my insurance, my credit card, and all the rest of it. And Airdrie Savings Bank couldn't give that suite of products to make money out of me. They could only give the basic, which doesn't make any money. And that's where the impact has really happened.
Okay. I'm happy to continue, Convener, if there is time.
That's another brief question. I should also add that the committee would welcome any further information in writing if you feel that you haven't had an opportunity to clarify as you would like, and some of the questions, obviously, you might like to come back on just to fill them out a bit or clarify what you may have said. So. Please bear that in mind. Professor Munn, a short question from Jackie Bailey, and then we'll come to John Mason, who's been mentioned already.
Okay. Can I ask about your customers? Because obviously the expectations, and it was what Wendy touched on, the expectations of the services they would get were different to the rest of the high street banks, but vastly better than credit unions. Was there any consideration given to kind of going back to a more credit union type model where there is a lighter touch in terms of regulation?
Yes, actually that was one of the strategic options that we did actually look at. I think it was aspirationally, it was appealing in a number of ways. It would have proved quite complicated in order to try and it would have been easier to set up a new credit union potentially and with elements of the bank rather than to try and do a conversion process. Okay. And indeed, working with the local credit unions and in the, it might well still be something that happens during the course of the wind down here. We're very much open to that.
Okay. Do the local credit unions bank with you then? Or do they bank elsewhere?
I think that a number of my banking colleagues in other banks have made active plays to attract business okay. from a number of the credit unions. Okay. But I think we enjoy good relations with a number of the local credit unions.
Thank you.
May I just add a thought to okay.
Jackie Bailey's
first? Yes, certainly, Professor.
First question, which is about skills and employability. For many years, I was chief executive of the Institute of Bankers in Scotland. And in the 90s, when banks started deciding that they no longer wanted to employ bankers but salespeople, a lot of the traditional bankers we've been talking about left the service. And I and my colleagues were able to help quite a number of people find employment. And we were pleased and surprised to discover that their skills were transferable, and not just into other financial services companies, but into a wide range of enterprises and public service. I'm sure that's still the case.
To hear.
Thank you. John Mason.
Hey, thanks, Convener. I mean, we've covered quite a lot of ground already. I suppose, you know, we've talked about the regulation side and the impact that's had, and then Gillian Martin talked about the, you know, the modernisation side, and it seems to me there's kind of two issues in there. I should say, I mean, I am one of the people that deliberately moved to Airdrie Savings Bank because I was fed up with the bigger banks, and I am incredibly disappointed that you're not going to be there anymore. However, that's the way it's going. But, I mean, even if we hadn't had all the other banking problems and all the extra regulation, was it almost inevitable that the modernisation process and, I mean, I don't have a contactless card, for example, was that just going to squeeze you anyway, whatever happened?
Contactless is actually a good example of an additional burden that perhaps is not necessarily one would call as a regulatory burden. But certainly the way we are set up with our terms of our membership of Visa, Visa and pushing contactless cards has been quite a strong agenda item over the last principally couple of years, really, not much beyond that. And as a result, Visa basically mandated that all members had to make their cards contactless by a particular date. And as a card issuer, that would indeed have been another quite major project that we would have had to work out how we were going to deal with and to make the cards contactless on that basis. And also beyond that, it potentially brings in an additional level of risk in terms of cyber risk and fraud risk through contactless transactions, which we're not exposed to at the moment because we're just chip and pin on the card process. So, yes, I think there's no question that as the cost base shifted and needed to be redressed, even if we hadn't gone through the level of extent that we have, there still would require to have been fundamental changes in strategy within the bank.
I mean, I'm not a banker, I'm an accountant by background, so I don't really know all the details of banking. But if you say you were introduced something like the contactless payments, I mean, is there a kind of lump sum that you have to pay, you know, a kind of one-off cost for new equipment and things, and then also an extra cost per card, or, you know, how does that all work out?
Yeah, so every time a customer uses their card for anything, be it in an ATM machine, be it to buy something, contactless or chip and pin, the bank gets charged for that. And so there has to be a way of recouping those funds. So in order to run the project, for example, we would have to set up an internal project, probably involve external IT, require testing of a third party, require to pay Visa to set up their project team in order to run it, and then purchase a whole new stock of cards for all the customers before actually even sending them out to them. So it was quite a major project.
Right. So I mean, even in the banking system, without leaving aside the regulation, you're a small player and you're struggling to kind of compete and work with all of that. I mean, it had been suggested, I think, that maybe you join up with another bank at some point, which would have overcome some of these kind of problems. Was that ever really seriously considered?
Yes, absolutely. I think whether or not we could, in fact, I might bring Charles in to say a wee bit specifically on the structure, but that was a strategic objective that we looked at. But for various reasons, again, relating to the corporate structure, a merger or a takeover isn't possible in that fashion. Charles, do you want to?
Yeah, I mean, there are plenty of examples, historical and more recent, where small organisations have got into partnership arrangements with other, sometimes larger organisations, to share resource or to develop a product or pursue a project. And indeed, when the Airdrie Savings Bank first got into lending, it did so through the Bank of Scotland in the 1970s and 80s. So, and we're beginning to see that kind of thing too, even in the credit union movement, you know, where I think it's actually the Department of Work and Pensions has put up quite a bit of money to provide a common platform for them so that a lot of the overheads can be shared, and so that the banking systems, you know, the simple ledger stuff can be operated in a common basis, you know, over a number of credit unions, so that each credit union doesn't then have to set up its own facility and incur all the costs, some of which, as Rod has said, the start-up costs of these things are where the damage is really done when it comes to incurring cost.
I mean, I don't know if this is outside your field, but I mean, the EU has been mentioned because some of the regulation is at an EU level. And my understanding was that I happened to be in Spain last week and Germany and places, that there are more small banks in some of these countries. Are they coping with this, do you know, or are they facing the same problems?
Not just in Europe, the United States, same sort of thing. I spent a year recently in the States and I still have a joint account with my American wife in a little bank in a little town in Massachusetts, in the hills, and it's wonderful. I mean, it reminds me of the Airdrie Savings Bank every time I think about it, you know, because the parallels are so strong. But all the other local banks around it have merged. It's the only survivor of a whole raft of little banks that existed for a very long time in those local little towns. It's real small town America. Similar things. I mean, it's not possible to generalise across Europe because such a diverse place. But there's been a lot of merger activity of small banks, particularly at the size of Airdrie Savings Bank. I mean, when I heard the news that it was to close, I was hugely disappointed, but I cannot say that I was entirely surprised.
Mm-hmm. I mean, can I ask the union on that point? Were was the union surprised, or did the staff just accept this as was inevitable?
I think there's a couple of things in that one. Were we surprised it was coming? Yeah, of course we were, because we've been working with the bank. You know, as Rod had said earlier, the bank had 9 or 10 branches, and every year they were doing another strategic review to reduce the branch network because the footfall had been falling, and you know, banking has changed for everyone, and you know, we're living in a reality TV kind of world now where everything has to happen immediately, and Airdrie Savings Bank can't sustain that kind of demand. So we had went from 9 or 10 branches and with the staff in there down to 3 branches. When the announcement was made, obviously it was a shock, and it's a shock to the staff as well, because one of the things, as well, I think they could be snapped up. There's a lot of people who are quite they've been loyal to Airdrie Savings Bank for lots of years, and there's people there who've worked there for 40 years, and not just one individual, but there's a lot of people who've done that, and there's families in there. So it is a community hit. So there is a shock, and can they get other jobs? I'm really, really confident with their skills they can, but they have a confidence thing, and they're quite institutionalised, and I'm not saying in a bad way, but you know, when you've been in a job for with a company for a long time, you know, it's quite a difficult prospect or idea to leave that. So there will be real challenges in that. But you know, it was sort of expected because of the low interest rate, because of the increased regulation, and because of the digital age. You know, you could see that they were really struggling.
So Unite and the staff are not kind of... You kind of agree basically with the trustees or the board's decision as to this was
Unite would never agree to job losses.
No, not the job losses, obviously, but the decision to close the bank rather than struggle on or do something.
Would I like to see them try to struggle? If they went through every avenue they possibly could that I can see it. I'm not a banker. I've never been in a banker, and never would want to be a banker, I have to say. But they've explored every avenue, and I've never heard anyone coming up with another alternative.
Okay, thanks. And I think the final point I wanted to ask about, I mean, there was a few years ago when a number of people thought the Airdrie Savings Bank was the model for the future, and there was a bit of an injection, I think, of money, and there was a new branch was opened. Was it Falkirk? I can't remember. Or
the international
somewhere.
Branch.
Was it? you know, was that over-optimistic at the time, or what happened to that?
I think that's a good example. Back in 2010, I think it was widely reported that a number of Scottish business people were supporting the bank. And I think the media probably reported it as that they had invested within the bank. As we've been discussing today, there is no mechanism, and that's again one of the challenges that we've had strategically. There is no mechanism to actually invest funds within the Airdrie Savings Bank. Retained reserves and capital is built up by retained profits. So essentially we worked closely with them in order to establish the branch connection out in Falkirk. Back in 1997, I believe, Airdrie Savings Bank had closed a branch that it had in Whifflet. And at actual fact had kept that expertise for that period of time within the bank, and so they were then able to redeploy it out to Falkirk in a new launch, and certainly Falkirk started off very buoyantly. We were pleased with the results and the way that was heading. I think things structurally changed around Falkirk not long after we moved in there, and a new retail park opened and further out of the town. The footfall appeared to get even less within the city centre, and fairly quickly the business that we had there, certainly coming through the door, tailed off. And when there was a position came up with regard to the lease that we decided that we wouldn't renew at that point. So I think we were thinking at the time that in order to push ourselves out there, that had been a successful to an extent kind of escapade, but it hadn't actually been, we hadn't established a model that we felt then was able to be replicated, which the bank could then build on.
Okay, thank you. Andy Whiteman.
Thank you, convener. Wendy mentioned the fact that, you know, it's recklessness and criminality of the financial sector that has ultimately led to the kind of regulatory regime that is now impacting on your sector, which was never designed for your sector because your sector never caused any of these problems. I just want to reflect on John Mason's point about other European banks. I mean, in Germany, for example, the Sparkassen network is 431 of them. There's a trillion euros assets, 115,000 branches, over 250,000 people employed, and they're a key supporter of German industry. So it's not that the savings bank model can't work. The savings bank model, it works extremely well in countries like Germany. I'm just wondering what wider lessons there are for our banking and savings culture in the UK. Is there something fundamentally wrong with the way the UK approaches the question of how banks are organised and structured?
Perhaps Professor Munn, would you have a comment on that, first of all?
Thank you, I think. We don't have a savings culture. And, you know, there's good logic in that, because with a very low interest rate environment such as we have, and the easy and cheap accessibility to credit, the savings culture that we once had has evaporated. It no longer exists. It once existed very strongly, and Airdrie Savings Bank did a lot to encourage it, especially through the work that they did in schools. We had a national savings system in the UK. That was abandoned, I think, in the 1970s, when the other problem that we talked about a little bit earlier of high inflation also did a lot of damage to the savings culture. We have this spend before you earn culture now, and that is not conducive to the running of a bank such as Airdrie.
But the wider culture in countries like Germany is people save in savings banks.
It's a very different
They invest in local industry to create jobs that generate wages that they save in the bank that finances the industry. So the broader question is, how do you... You know, is it about the ecology of banking and how it's connected with a country's industrial, manufacturing, and economic base, as much as it is to do with the financial sector itself?
Yeah, and the Germans don't buy houses. Our cards are very moderately used there. It's a really serious difference. You know, and it's hard to make the connections. One of the things that's been said for all time, really, about banking in the United Kingdom is that it doesn't serve industry particularly well. Nearly all the academic studies that have looked at that have countered that argument and said, well, that's not true. And a lot of the things that I've written in banking histories have confirmed that, you know, that there's been no great evidence. Whether you look back to the Macmillan Committee in 1931 and beyond that, a lot of the other criticisms that have been made, and there's no real evidence to show that industry has been starved of funds. I've had lots of arguments with this about people over the years, because people, given my kind of background, will look for an argument and say, you know, you banks are not doing your job properly, you're not helping local industry. But when I was running the Committee of Scottish Clearing Bankers for a time, we asked the banks every few months how many accounts they had opened for new businesses. Now, these might just be hobby businesses, certainly not businesses that were registered for VAT at £60,000 of turnover. And we came up with very substantial numbers, which gave the lie to what was often reported in the press, you know, that the new business generation numbers in Scotland were poor compared with other countries. They weren't. It was what was being counted and how it was being counted that made the difference. So, you know, if we're trying to suggest that there is some major cultural, structural difference between Germany and the UK, okay, there might be, but I don't think that that includes any deficit in the part of the banking fraternity.
Okay, thank you.
Just perhaps to follow up on that, Professor Munn, you said that in Germany the culture is very different. I think one of the comments you made was about the fact that people there would tend to use cash more, if I understood you correctly, than they do in this country. So cash rather than cards. And the other, the comment about the Falkirk Bank that Rod Ashley made, the opening of the branch and then a new shopping centre being built elsewhere, footfall falling away. Are there a number of factors such as that that perhaps there's not the joined up thinking in this country, whereas in Germany there may be, as well as cultural differences in how people approach money that might tend to support the type of model that Andy Whiteman's talking about?
Well, it's certainly the case that the way that people approach money is changing, and it's changing quite dramatically. You know, we've talked about the cashless society in the UK for quite a long time now. It now seems to be arriving. It's taken quite some time to get here. The point of that, of course, is that people don't go into their branches anymore. It's almost unheard of. They don't use cheques anymore to make payments. You know, it's all online banking, it's telephone banking, and the need for a branch network compared with what it once was when I was a young bank clerk in the 60s is just so incredibly different from what it used to be. And large organisations have to deal with those changes. We shouldn't think that, I mean, I'm not an expert in Germany, far from it, but we shouldn't think Germany is some wonderful model for us all to follow, because their big commercial banks have had great difficulties too, particularly Deutsche Bank. But Deutsche Bank isn't the behemoth in Germany that, you know, the likes of Barclays is in the United Kingdom. You know, it's got, is it 5 or 10% of the deposits? Where Germany, to take your point fully on, I think it has an advantage is that it has a lot of regional banks, but they're not small. They're not organisations the size of Airdrie Savings Bank. The Sparkassen savings bank model may have had its origins in Rothwell to some extent, as the rest of the savings bank movement did. But it moved in different directions in the 19th century, and these Sparkassen became, to all intents and purposes, commercial lending banks at a very early stage in their history, and are very considerably larger than the likes of the Airdrie Savings Bank, with something in the order of £150 million of deposits.
Thank you. And you mentioned, sorry, Wendy Dunsmore.
The footfall in branches in the wider context. The big banks have deliberately, in my view, wanted the branch closures, branch network closures. They have targeted staff to get people to open internet banking and telephone banking. And if you don't hit your target, you are going through a performance management process, which could ultimately end up in dismissal. So the companies, the big banks have actually determined that they want to have these call centres or internet banking centres, and then therefore the footfall does have an impact. The other impact that was that stopped people going into branches, and I'm one of them, is because every time you went in, the staff had to try and sell you something. So rather than that, you try to avoid to be saying, no, I don't want anything, I'll just go into internet banking. And that's having a real impact in rural communities now. So the banks have deliberately done this, whether it's been very visible or not is irrelevant. And now the internet banking is now going to be a real problem for communities, and rural communities in particular. So there is another strategy going on out there that's not as visible to our communities as should be.
And I suppose there may be strategies that may have unintended consequences as well. Would you accept that?
Absolutely. If you look at what the banks are doing just now, and I'm going to pick one place that just happened really recently. The one place is that Inverary had a Bank of Scotland and a Royal Bank of Scotland until January this year. Bank of Scotland closed November, December time, and I think the Royal Bank closed in January, all down to, you've got digital banking. They don't have an internet service. They don't have internet access, as good as strong internet access. So that community is going to be quite rural and quite cut off from banking. They're also cutting back the buses, and the nearest town is either Dumbarton or Lochgilphead. So individuals and, you know, the people who do use the banks, the vulnerable in society, the older people, the younger people, and the disabled, they can't get anywhere to use banking facilities unless they've got internet, really strong internet access, and Inveraray doesn't have it. So there is unintended consequences, but I'm not so convinced that they were properly unintended, because branches are quite expensive to run, and banks are there to make money for their shareholders. Not Airdrie Savings Bank, they're a true bank, but the other ones, I'm not completely convinced that it was unintended.
Just one question, perhaps, Professor Munn, and that's about the, you talked about, I think you mentioned cheques, and if I recall correctly, in the recent past, there was a move to get rid of cheques as a service, and that in fact didn't happen because I think people pointed out that that was would present difficulties to, for example, elderly people or those who have to pay by cheque. Could you comment on that? And perhaps looking at what we've been asking, question about lessons for the future, what we can learn from this as to how to approach things to ensure that elderly, disabled, vulnerable people, those who don't have access to the internet, can continue to have banking services.
Yep. Well, the last I caught up on the cheques question, I understand that it's still the ambition of the banks to end the use of cheques. There are plenty of other ways to make payments. As we know, you can do it on the telephone, you can do it on the internet, assuming you've got an internet service, which is clearly not always the case. You can still do it by send a cheque through the post at the moment. Quite what the future holds, I wish I knew. We're clearly at a very, very serious change in the way that people deal with money and the way that they run their own financial affairs. I just wish I could see with great clarity, you know, what the future might hold. Historians like me are supposed to be able to do that, you know, because history is supposed to teach you what the future might hold. All I can offer is that we'll get more of this type of change, and it's clear too that all sorts of other agencies like Apple are entering into the payments arena now. And, you know, that's going to bring further change, but it's also going to make inroads into the business of the commercial banks. So, you know, if we allow that to happen in the way that it is already happening, and to expand, then we'll get to the point where the commercial banks, we may actually be in this situation already, are, you know, experiencing the same kind of pressures as the Airdrie Bank has experienced. For the simple reason that, you know, particularly in running current accounts, it's virtually impossible for a commercial bank to make money running current accounts nowadays. So that's why they've become sales organisations. They're trying to make the money doing other things.
Gil Patterson.
Having stood in Airdrie shots twice for the Scottish Parliament and getting elected in 1999, although I didn't get elected in Airdrie shots because I was on the list, I find this a very, very sad occasion, to be quite honest with you, because I know that from the local community's perspective, it's so well respected, it's so well trusted, and of course, in your closing, that you've just proven that the responsible way that you're carrying this out is, you know, I commend the way that you're going about your business. It's absolutely correct the way you're doing it. But looking at your submission, there's quite a number of issues in there that's maybe putting the pressure on you. And I wondered if there was maybe one or two items that didn't occur, if there was something that, you know, that you could avoid or it didn't happen. You know, is there something that was a killer blow, in other words, that I'm asking?
I think if you ask me what's the one overarching factor that's influenced the business model of the bank that has been out with the bank's control, it would be the lower for longer interest rate position that we find ourselves in. I think when the rates dropped to 0.05 of a percentage point back in 2008, 2009, I think the trustees at Airdrie and the board then took the right actions. As we discussed earlier, they had built up some reserves. These were then being used to provide the service within the community, but we looked to see what we might be able to change. Certainly, I don't know, Professor, I've certainly attended presentations, I think, since 2009, with economists telling me that rates will rise just around the corner, and we're still here in 2017. This is partly influenced, I think, by the keeping of the interest rates low policy by the central government, and the support that it's providing behind the scenes for the larger banks to be able to take money from them at low cost and pump that out in the form of low rates. And that vests itself in interbank lending rates being low for the bank. Obviously, we all know the retail deposit rates that we're receiving on interest are very low, but also through the mortgage market as well, as deals are able to be offered with very low rates of interest on that, again making it more difficult even for organisations such as ourselves to enter into that arena. So in summary, I think the one item I think that's affected the model most is the interest rate environment.
And that's the one you've got least influence over, actually, isn't it?
Yes.
Yeah. And I suppose the second question, the only people that have are governments that have got the powers to influence that. So, and the current climate, or as it was, it's that would be an impossible ask even to save your bank.
Mm-hmm. And that low interest rate environment is a challenge appreciated by the other banks as well. But just as Wendy was alluding to, their business models are structured completely different to ours in terms of other ways that they will be able to raise income.
Okay, thanks very much for that. Thanks.
Might I just clarify one thing on the last point? I understand the point about where the government supports certain schemes or lending schemes for example, first-time buyers, but is it not worldwide that the interest rates are low at this time? And also, it's the Bank of England that, independent of government, sets the interest rate.
Yes, I think the interest rates perhaps are not universally worldwide that low. For example, I know in Australia they're not; they never dropped to as low a level as they did in this country. But certainly across Europe, and certainly in America, although they've crept up just a smidge from where we were, that would be the case. Yes, and I think the independence of the Bank of England there to control the inflationary pressure is right. I think it's not necessarily I'm thinking of the first-time buyer type schemes. I'm thinking of government schemes such as the Funding for Lending scheme and its successors, which was a fund by which the bank and through the government, banks, really bigger banks, could enter into it and then obtain funds at a low rate of cost.
Was that something that the Airdrie Savings Bank was able to do, or was that something that didn't fit within your product?
Technically, we could have applied for it, but it's a scale question, really a scale and cost question, that we were not big enough to do that and to take advantage of it.
Bill Bowman?
A quick question for Mr. Ashley again. I don't know if you said, and if you didn't, could you tell us what happens to any surplus at the end of a winding up?
So the governance structure of the bank is the 1819 Act. Then there's a set of rules, orders and regulations, which are subject to the jurisdiction of the Sheriff Principal, in our case at Airdrie, so close by. Under the terms of those rules, if at the end of the day, in terms of a final winding up of the bank, there is, and we don't know at the moment, but we're anticipating that there may be a surplus of assets over liabilities, then that requires to be returned to the depositors in such proportion as they had deposited in the bank at a date and time, such date and time to be established by the Board of Trustees. So, to be honest, at the moment we haven't given a lot of thought to exactly where that would be. It's likely that date will not be a future date as far as the bank is concerned. It will be a date in the past. And also, we suspect that it's likely that there will be a very, if there were to be a surplus, which we hope that there will be, because of the large number of low-level depositors we have, any potential payment to anybody will be of a small nature. And consequently, the board are considering various options, among which are, is there a way of approaching the court and establishing whether or not these funds could be used in a community, charitable kind of fashion in some capacity? But there's no definitive answer for you on that at this point in time.
Ash Denham.
Can you explain what your relationship was like with the PRA? Were they easy or difficult to deal with?
So since I've been at the bank, which is from 2013, I think I would describe as a very encouraging relationship with the PRA. We have had a key team members, key managers appointed to the bank who have remained with us over that period of time, who I continue to work with on a week-to-week basis, very, very much so. They have taken quite a lot of time and effort to try and understand our business model and to listen and to hear our proposals for various strategic options as we've been going forward, and to be supportive and challenging as they need to be in relation to that. Their objective, obviously, as we know from the papers, a strong and secure financial sector. So I use the word encouraging because that's what they would like to see the entities to become. So I've been encouraged by the relationship that we have with them and continue to work with them.
Dean Lockhart.
Thank you. I just wanted to clarify a couple of points. You mentioned earlier that you considered yourself as a social enterprise. Just wanted to check, did you receive any funding or other help from any government agency as a social enterprise, Scottish Enterprise or Social Enterprise Scotland?
I'll tell you the answer, and I'm not sure which bracket it will fill into there. So the two projects that I referred to earlier in terms of helping us to move into the mortgage intermediary market and helping us to establish in the social enterprise sector, we obtained funding and support from Scottish Enterprise with staffing costs to get that established. That was the support that we obtained. So I probably wouldn't have described a specific social enterprise support, but certainly it was helpful and appreciated.
And just one follow-up point on the winding up process. What will happen to any outstanding loans or mortgages you have, given if you do have loans or mortgages outstanding, they tend to be longer-term assets? Do you have a plan in place? What's the plan in place to wind down those longer term assets?
So we've been working with the TSB, who have been a partner with us really in this process, and the secured lending book has been sold across to them. So mortgages will be in the process of moving across currently to TSB. With regard to the unsecured lending, we've contacted the customers to explain the situation and to look at working with them to find out how they might be able to repay us. But given the loan profile, a lot of the lending wasn't necessarily profiled over a large outlying number of years. So the vast majority of it will be due for repayment in the normal course over the next 12, 18 months or whatever. So a lot of it will be able to remain just on normal repayment terms. Some customers have said that they will move and they'll look to go elsewhere, but we're kind of committed to working with each of the customers on that basis to find a solution that works for them.
Thank you.
Richard Leonard, I think, had one further, perhaps, final question.
Yeah, just a final point, and I don't want to either raise false hope nor put words in your mouth, Mr. Ashley, but in answer to a question that Jackie Bailey posed earlier on, you hinted that there may be a possibility of a phoenix rising from the ashes of the Airdrie Savings Bank. Is there any possibility of anything being rescued from the great reputation the bank's established for over 180 years in maybe a different model of ownership?
I suspect that at this point in time, my hesitation was more uncertainty about what the future might be holding at that point rather than anything that I could say that would be definitive. The position at the moment is that the bank will wind down. The current accounts in the bank account, the branches are closing at the end of April during the course of 2017. We will then get to a position where there will be a residual set of deposits left, and then the trustees will need to find another deposit taker in order to move that book of residual assets to. The project has been scoped very much out to that point at the moment, and we're just looking at the options in relation to that. Whether or not there is, and I certainly don't want to give any hope that there is something there, but how that actually ends up being settled has yet to be established. But I think in a practical sense, we have to work on the basis that we're winding down, and that there will be some sort of community legacy in relation to the bank rather than a banking one.
But it might take the form of a credit union.
I think that was the specific point that Jack and I were talking about. I think that, well, again, not saying that anything's been discussed on that basis, I can see the similarities between the bank and a credit union. As Charles has said, in actual fact, if we were based in America or even Canada, Airdrie Savings Bank would in fact be a credit union, because that's the model that it follows. So they are close. Yeah.
But operating under quite a different regulatory regime.
Yes, the credit unions to an extent benefited from having the specialist source book that they have with regard to regulation, where at least everything is kept condensed. And certainly at the time I worked there, and I'm removed from there for a number of years now, so I can't comment on the current position. The regime was quite different to that which flowed under the banks.
Thank you.
Thank you, and I think Andy Whiteman did want to get a final question in, so perhaps that, and I think perhaps
yes,
on to say something.
Sorry, thank you, Convener. On the assumption that the winding up does complete, where are your artefacts, archives, this long history must have generated? Are you planning to deposit in the National Archives, or what arrangements have been made?
So currently I've been contacted by a number of organisations. There's the National Business Archives for Scotland. I've been in touch. I've also spoken to the Savings Bank Museum in Ruthwell with regard to any particular archives there, and also North Lanarkshire Culture and Heritage, who are the local authority area in which we vest, and they in particular have a heritage museum out at Summerlee. So I'm confident that the archives and the legacy will end up in the most appropriate place for it, that it can be seen and shared with the community.
Thank you.
All right, well, I think that concludes our questions for today. May I thank all three of you for coming in. I'm sure the committee would agree with me that it's regrettable that it's in these circumstances that we've invited you here, if I may put it that way, but I'm sure also the committee would wish to send their best wishes to all those involved, and in particular the workers at Airdrie Savings Bank, and wish you all the best for the future. Thank you very much. We'll now suspend this session. We'll return to public session at 11:30 a.m.